We're on Daf Tzadi Vav Amud Aleph. Yesterday we had gone through a number of different suggestions of the Gemara as to what the basis of the machlokas between the Rabban, the Tanakhama, and Rabban Gamliel in our Mishnah is. They were speaking about when you find tefillin out in an unprotected public area, how do you get it into a safe, preserved place? And the Chachamim said you could wear zug zug. You can only wear one pair at a time and bring it back. Rabban Gamliel had said that you can wear two pairs at a time. So the Gemara was discussing all the different ways that we try to understand the machlokas. The first way that the Gemara tried to suggest it is that the Tanakhama holds that there's a mitzvah of tefillin on Shabbos. And as such, if you were to put on a second pair of tefillin, there would be two problems, potentially, of wearing a second pair on Shabbos. Number one, there's a problem of bal tosif, of adding on to the mitzvah in a way that was never prescribed by the Torah, which is in itself prohibited. And the second problem is that if the Chachamim view the rationale for allowing you to wear tefillin on Shabbos is not because it's a malbush, is not because it's like an article of clothing, like a cap, but rather it's because it's something that adorns you by virtue of the fact that you're doing a mitzvah, then any pair of tefillin that you're wearing where you're not doing the mitzvah because you've already got a first pair on, then you would be considered carrying it. So the two problems, according to the Chachamim, of wearing a second pair of tefillin is A, bal tosif, and B, hotza'ah. According to Rabban Gamliel, you're allowed to wear two pairs of tefillin because Rabban Gamliel could potentially hold that there is no mitzvah of tefillin on Shabbos, and therefore the whole reason why the Chachamim allow you to wear it is not because you're doing a mitzvah, but because it's a malbush, because it's a like an article of clothing, and when it comes to clothing, you can put on as many caps as you can fit on your head. And two pairs is the amount that you can fit on your head. That was the conventional way of understanding it. The Gemara had offered different permutations of that same principle, but that's the basic gist. The Gemara had also suggested that it's possible that even Rabban Gamliel holds that the Shabbos is man tefillin, that the mitzvah of tefillin applies on Shabbos as well, and that we'd have to modify Rabban Gamliel's position slightly, that there's no problem of bal tosif, unless you have kavana for bal tosif and so forth and so on. So
how would you wear two? By the way, you'd have like shell rushes here, one by the one.
No, be presumably one above the other.
Ah, okay. Right.
One just
one.
Right.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah. Okay. So, but the assumption that the Gemara is working under is that at least according to the Tanakhama, there's a mitzvah of tefillin on Shabbos. And this is now going to be the source of the Gemara's concern. Where do we ever find that there's someone who holds that presumably there is no mitzvah? You and I know that there's no mitzvah of tefillin on Shabbos because you and I don't wear tefillin on Shabbos. And that seems to be the presumption that the Gemara is working under as well. So the Gemara is basically saying, and now we're like the 15th line or something, I'm not sure exactly, Uman Shamas Le Shabbos Man Tefillin. Which opinion states that Shabbos, that the tefillin is, there's a mitzvah of tefillin on Shabbos? Rabbi Akiva. Oh, so the Gemara first says it's Rabbi Akiva. The Tanya, v'shomarto esachuko hazos lamo ado miyomim yomima. If you look towards the end of Parshas Bo, after the Torah gives us all of the mitzvahs of Pesach, of Korban Pesach, and then it talks about the mitzvah of wearing tefillin, and then it says at the end, "V'shamarta sechuko hazos lamoado." You shall preserve this statute at its proper time, miyamim yamima, from days to days. So yamim velo leilos, miyamim velo kol yamim, prat l'shabbosus v'yamim tovim. Divir Rabbi Aglili. Rabbi Yossi Aglili is of the opinion that what the word miyamim teaches us, the word yamim without the mem teaches us that it applies only at day and not at night, the mitzvah of tefillin, which is the last mitzvah mentioned before this pasuk. And when it says miyamim, it means to exclude even certain days from the mitzvah of tefillin, which means that on Shabbos and Yom Tov you don't have a mitzvah of tefillin. But Rabbi Akiva disagrees. Rabbi Akiva omer, lo ne'amar chukazu ela le'inyon pesach bilvad, that this pasuk is not a reference to the mitzvah of tefillin. It's a mitzvah, it's a reference to the larger mitzvah that was referenced in the chapter, which is about the mitzvah of Korban Pesach. And all the Torah is telling you is that you have to preserve this statute on an annual basis. That's what miyamim yamima means, that from days to days, which means from year to year, you have to do this mitzvah annually. That's all the Torah is telling you. And therefore, because Rabbi Akiva does not use this pasuk to exclude the mitzvah of tefillin from certain times, we see that Rabbi Akiva holds that the mitzvah of tefillin is constant, and therefore you have the mitzvah even on Shabbos and Yontif. Ve'elaha d'tnan, but wait a minute now, says the Gemara. We have another Mishnah that says, ha-pesach ve'hamila mitzvah saseh, that the Korban Pesach and Bris Milah are two unique mitzvah saseh, positive commandments. In what sense are they unique? Because all other mitzvah saseh, if I don't perform them, I don't get a heavy penalty. These are the only two mitzvah saseh that through my non-performance of them, I get kares. And furthermore, normally when you get kares for violating the Torah, if you do it b'shogeg, you have to bring a korban chatas. But because these are a mitzvah saseh, then you don't have to bring a korban chatas if you violated them b'shogeg. Now, lema delo karebi akiva. That statement that the korban pesach is only a mitzvah saseh would seem not to be in sync with this Rabbi Akiva that we just cited. De'i Rabbi Akiva, Akivan demoki la bepesach, lav nami ika. He says, since Rabbi Akiva uses the pasuk of v'shamarta sachukah hazos lamo adam yomim yomima, he says that that pasuk is a reference to Korban Pesach. Well, that pasuk is phrased as a mitzvah lo saseh. It's phrased as a negative commandment. And therefore, according to Rabbi Akiva, Korban Pesach should not just be a mitzvah aseh, it should be a mitzvah aseh and a mitzvah lo saseh. Kidder Rabbi Abin, as Rabbi Abin had taught, Amar Rabbi Eloi, in the name of Rabbi Eloi, Demar Abin Amar Rabbi Eloi, Kol Makom Shemar Yishomer Pen Va'al, Eino Ela Belo Sa'aseh, that any time the Torah uses a language of Hishamer, that you have to be careful, or Pen, lest, or Va'al, shall not, or do not, all of these terms are terms of a mitzvah lo saseh. Here the Torah says v'shamarta, which is like hishamer, be careful. And if so, then the phraseology of this pasuk implies a mitzvah lo saseh. If Rabbi Akiva says that this pasuk is a reference to Korban Pesach and not a reference to tefillin, then it seems like he can't subscribe to the Mishnah, which says that Korban Pesach is merely a mitzvah saseh. So the Gemara says no. Afilu tema Rabbi Akiva, hishamer de lav lav, hishamer de aseh aseh. No, the Gemara says you didn't understand the statement of Rabbi Eloi. Rabbi Eloi was telling you that whenever the Torah uses the word hishamer in the context of a mitzvah lo saseh, it's coming to add another mitzvah lo saseh. So for example, when the Torah says hishamer lecha pentichros bris, be careful that you do not make a covenant with the indigenous nations of Canaan. That is where the word hishamer is implying that if you do so, you violate a mitzvah lo saseh in the Torah. But if the word hishamer or v'shamarta is used in the context of a positive commandment, then it does not mean to imply a mitzvah lo saseh. All it's telling you is to be careful to fulfill the positive commandment. In any event, let's go back to the presumption that Rabbi Akiva holds that Shabbos is a time of wearing tefillin. V'sofer Rabbi Akiva Shabbos man tefillin hu? V'hatanya, Rabbi Akiva Omer, Yochel Yaniach Adam Tefillin B'Shabbosos V'Yomim Toivim. There's an explicit brisa that says, quoting Rabbi Akiva, you might think that you can wear tefillin on Shabbos and Yontif. Tamulomar V'Hayalecha La'os Al Yadicha. Harold, you see it? So the Torah says that the tefillin shall be a sign, an os, on your arm. Right? So what does the word sign tell me? Mishutzrichen os, Yatsu Elu Shehin Gufan os. There's only a mitzvah of tefillin on days where that is the only sign available to you. But when you're in the midst of a holy day, which is in itself a sign, you're enveloped by the moment of this holiness, by the sign itself that you're connected to Hashem, it is no longer necessary for you to wear tefillin because the sign itself is your observance of the holy day. And therefore, you're exempt, according to Rabbi Akiva, from tefillin on Shabbos and Yontif. So you see very clearly that Rabbi Akiva, even though Rabbi Akiva says that the pasuk that we cited before, miyamim yamima, is not a reference to tefillin, but he still holds that you're exempt from tefillin on Shabbos. Elahai tanahu. But rather, says the Gemara, it's the following tana who holds that it's the following tana who holds that there's a mitzvah of tefillin on Shabbos. The Tanya Haneir Belai LaRatza Choletz Ratza Miniach Divir Reb Nasan. That if a person stays up all night, let's say he's got the night shift, so then if he wants to, he can take off his tefillin. If he wants to, he can wear tefillin because the nighttime is the time of tefillin according to Rebbe Nasan. But Yonasan Hakitoni Omer Ein Manichin Tefillin Belaila. But Yonasan Hakitoni disagrees, and he says, you're not allowed to put on tefillin at night. Now, the reason you're not allowed to put on tefillin at night, what's the iser? Because we're worried that you may fall asleep. And in the midst of falling asleep, you're not in control always of your bodily functions, and therefore you may do something like flatulate in your sleep, which would be a desecration of the tefillin. So that's why we don't, he says, since there's no mitzvah of tefillin at night, you cannot put on tefillin at night. But Rabbi Nassim says, as long as you're awake, it's perfectly fine. So midalayla l'tanakam is man tefillin, Shabbos nami is man tefillin. So let us infer that just like Rabbi Nassim holds that there's a mitzvah of tefillin at night, so too, if there's a mitzvah of tefillin on Shabbos, because he clearly holds that there's no time restriction. So presumably he holds that there's no time restriction as far as Shabbos and Yontif as well. So the Gemara says, no, Vidilma Svirle, Laila's Mantfilin Hu, Shabbos loves Mantfilin Hu, the Hashamina Leila Rebbe Akiva, the Omar Laila's Mantfilin Hu, Shabbos loves Mantfilin Hu. The Gemara says, no, not necessarily. Reb Nassim could subscribe to Rebbe Akiva, just like Rebbe Akiva. Look, Rebbe Akiva says that even though I don't use the pasuk of Yamim Yamima to exclude tefillin from certain times when you're exempt from wearing tefillin, I still hold that you're exempt from wearing tefillin on Shabbos because Shabbos itself is an os. Shabbos itself is a sign. So maybe Reb Nassim subscribes to that same principle, that just like there's a mitzvah, even though there's a mitzvah of tefillin at night because he doesn't use the pasuk of miyamim yamima, he still holds like Rabbi Akiva that there's no mitzvah of tefillin on Shabbos because Shabbos itself is an os. So where do you see from here that Reb Nassim holds that there's a mitzvah of tefillin on Shabbos? You don't necessarily see that. So Ela Haytanahu. So let me show you another brisa. Detanya, Michal bas Kushi haisa maneches tefillin. That Michal, the daughter of the Kush man, which is a reference to King Saul, she was the daughter of King Saul, and Saul is from Kush, or Kish, I should say. Kish is a descendant of Binyamin, and Saul is from the tribe of Binyamin. So, like Mordechai, it says, Ben Kish Ishimini. So therefore, Michal bas Kushi is, she used to put on tefillin, and the Chachamim did not, velo michu ba Chachamim, and the Chachamim did not protest. The ishto shel Yonah haisa ola l'regel, velo michu ba Chachamim. And Yonah, the prophet Jonah's wife, also used to make a pilgrimage to Yerushalayim during every regel, and the Chachamim there also did not protest. Even though one could argue that the mitzvah of making a pilgrimage is only for men. The Havamina of the Gemara is as follows. The Havamina of the Gemara is that the very fact that the Chachamim did not protest means that they felt that there is an acceptable mitzvah for a woman to put on tefillin. Here the Gemara is working under the following assumption. If a woman does not have a mitzvah of tefillin, then she should not put on tefillin. But the fact that the Chachamim did not protest is a sign that a woman does have a mitzvah of tefillin. Now, I'll get to that in just a second. You asked, Bob, this Michal was King David's wife, yes, for a time. So the Gemara now says, Midelo michu ba chachamim amla kasavri mitzvah sase shelo azman gramahu. The only way that a woman could have a mitzvah of tefillin is if it's not a time-bound mitzvah. If it's not a time-bound mitzvah, it means that it applies at all times, including Shabbos. So therefore you see that there's at least one opinion that holds that you can put on tefillin, there's a mitzvah of tefillin on Shabbos. The Gemara says, but wait a minute, that's not necessarily so, because v'dilma savrla k'rebi Yosi, the Amar Nashim Samchos Rishus. Maybe this Tana holds like Rebbe Yosi, who holds that even if a woman is exempt from a mitzvah, she still is allowed to do a mitzvah if she wants to. Rebbe Yosi says that even though women are exempt from pressing down on an animal, which is called smicha, we call smicha the rabbinic ordination, but there's another kind of smicha, which is, there's Torah says, v'samach yado al rosh karbano. Before you bring a carbon, you have to press down with all your might over the animal's head to create that physical association between yourself and the animal. That mitzvah only applies to men, but not to women. But Rabbi Yossi says that if a woman really wants to, kazunta hate, she can certainly do it, even though it's a mitzvah from which she is exempt. And the Gemara says, I'll prove it to you. De'ilo teimahachi, ishto shel Yonah haisa olu l'regel v'lo michu ba mi'ika l'man da'amar regel av mitzvah sase shezman gramahu. Ela kasavar rishos, achanami rishos. What was the second example? The second example of Mrs. Yonah. She used to make a pilgrimage during the Shalosh Regalim. So you're going to tell me that that's not a time-bound mitzvah? Obviously that's a time-bound mitzvah. So just like that's a time-bound mitzvah and the rabbis did not protest because they felt that it's acceptable for a woman to do a mitzvah even though she's exempt, So too, Michal Bas Kushi, the reason why they didn't protest is not because it's not a time bound mitzvah, but even though it's a time bound mitzvah, even though she's exempt from it, they still allowed her to do it. So I want to just discuss a couple of things here that are very important before we go on to the next piece. Well, first of all, we're still stuck. We haven't found anyone who holds that there's a mitzvah of tefillin on Shabbos. So we still have to figure that out. But before we get to that point, let's talk a little bit about this whole principle that the Gemara, the assumption the Gemara was working on, at least temporarily, was that if a woman is exempt from a mitzvah, she's not allowed to do that mitzvah. Now, obviously, we don't paskin that way because we allow women to sit in the sukkah on sukkahs, and we allow women to do lots of mitzvahs, asay, that or not, that we allow a woman to, if a woman wants to hear tekiya shofar, and she feels it's important for her, we go over and blow shofar for her. Right, even though she's putter from the mitzvah of tekiyah shofar, right? Because it's a mitzvah sase shezman grama. So clearly, we don't subscribe. We subscribe to Rabbi Yossi in this regard. Tosfos goes so far as to point out that not only do we allow a woman to fulfill a mitzvah sase shezman grama, but we even allow her to make a bracha of asher kiddushanu b'mitzvosav. We even allow her to make a bracha on that. Right, and that's the very lengthy tosis that you see over here. Let me also talk about for a moment the din of Michal Bas Kushi that she put on tefillin, right? And the Gemara over here says the Chachamim did not protest. Tosis brings down from the Psiktaf, which from a Midrash, which has the exact opposite girsa, and says that the Chachamim did protest and did not allow her to put on tefillin. And this turns out to be a machlokus between the Machaber and the Rama in Shulchan Aruch, whether a woman is allowed to put on tefillin if she so desires. According to the Machaber, she's permitted to, and according to the Rama, she's not permitted to. And why is that? Because tefillin requires a guf naki. Tefillin requires a clean body. And essentially, any person who is, the attitude of the Rama is that any person who is exempt from the mitzvah of tefillin should not undertake to put on tefillin. Because it's difficult to maintain a guf naki, it's difficult to maintain a clean body at all times. Maybe you had some burritos the night before, and you're going to be gassy, and it's very difficult. And maybe you'll fall asleep, and you won't realize that you're flatulating in your tefillin. So that's why we don't permit anyone who's putter to put on tefillin. And that's why the Rama paskins that a woman may not put on tefillin. It's not, and like we pointed out before, it's not in the same realm of tzitzis. Tzitzis is if a woman really feels that she needs to, she can do it, right? It's only an issue if she shouldn't do it ostentatiously because then it represents arrogance. But if she feels that she really needs to resonate with this mitzvah, then gesuntehei, put it on underneath your clothing and no one will see it, and then you're perfectly okay. But when it comes to tefillin, we don't allow her to put on tefillin. There were certain women who did put on tefillin, so according to the psikta, it was wrong. It was wrong for them. Rashi's daughters, they say, put on tefillin, probably because they held like our Gemara, not like the psikta. Okay, so there's what to discuss here. Let us go on. We're still looking for a Tana who holds that there's a mitzvah of tefillin on Shabbos. Ella hai Tana hi. So rather, it's the following Tana. D'tanya hamotzei tefillin machnisen zug, echad ha'ish ve'echad ha'isha. So we have a braisa that elaborates on our mission. It says that if you find tefillin on Shabbos out in the open, you can wear them one pair at a time and walk back into the yishuv with them. And that applies both to men and both to women. Echad chadashos ve'echad yishanos. And that also applies to whether they're new or whether they're old. Not like our Mishnah had said. Our Mishnah had said that you can only do it if they're old tefillin, which means that they've already been tied and knotted properly. But if they're new, we have to worry that maybe they're not tefillin at all, but maybe they're a kameya. So this is according to Divrei Reb Meir, that he says there's no difference between men and women, and there's no difference between new tefillin and old tefillin.
What's a kameya?
As an amulet. So Rabbi Yehuda Oser b'chadosho sumatir b'yishanos. Rabbi Yehuda says, like our Mishnah, that you may not wear back the new, unused, untied tefillin. You can only wear the tefillin that has already been knotted properly. So ad kan lo pligi ela b'chadoshos b'yishanos avol b'isha lo pligi. Their only machlokas between Rabbi Yehuda and Rabbi Meir is as far as new tefillin versus old tefillin, but everyone agrees that both a man and a woman can wear tefillin on Shabbos. So you see that what? Shema mina, mitzvah sase, shelo azman grama, hu b'chol mitzvah sase, she'en azman grama, nashim chayavos. So you see that both according to Reb Meir and Reb Yehuda, women have a mitzvah of tefillin on Shabbos. Because if there was no mitzvah, then we would only allow a man to wear the tefillin. We wouldn't allow the woman to wear the tefillin. So you see from here that so you see very clearly that it's a mitzvah sase shelo azman grama, that it's not a time bound mitzvah. Women have this mitzvah of wearing tefillin, and if women have a mitzvah of wearing tefillin, then you also see from this brisa that the Shabbos is also is the zman of tefillin. In other words, the Gemara is basically saying is that you see very clearly, consistently with our Mishnah, that tefillin is not a time-bound mitzvah. It is not precluded from Shabbos. It's not precluded from women. So the Gemara says, but wait a minute. V'dilma savar la k'Reb Yosi d'amar nashim somchos rishus. But maybe that b'raisa also holds that women do not have a mitzvah of tefillin at all. And the reason why they're allowed to is like Reb Yosi said, that if a woman wants to do a mitzvah, that she's not obligated and she can do it and she gets reward for it, right? So maybe that's why Reb Meir and Reb Yehuda permit a woman to put on tefillin on Shabbos. The Gemara says, Lo sal gadaitach, de lo Reb Meir sarvala k'Reb Yosi, velo Reb Yehuda sarvala k'Reb Yosi. I will prove to you that's impossible, because I will show you that both Reb Meir and Reb Yehuda disagree with Reb Yosi, and they hold that if a woman is not obligated in a mitzvah, she may not do the mitzvah. So the very fact that Reb Meir and Reb Yehuda allow a woman to put on tefillin is a raya that they hold that she has a mitzvah to put on tefillin. Lo Rabbi Meir Savala K'Reb Yosi Ditnanein Ma'akvin Es Atinokos Miliskoa Hanoshe Ma'akvin. That there's a Mishnah that says that we never prevent children from blowing shofar. Right? It's the only people that are exempt from shofar that we don't prevent from blowing are children, I guess because for chinuch purposes. But women, it seems like, by inference, we do prevent women from blowing shofar. So you see that if a woman doesn't have a mitzvah, because it's a mitzvah, sasei shazman grama, then according to Reb Meir, we don't allow them. How do you know that this is Reb Meir? Because ustamas nisan Reb Meir. When we have an anonymous Mishnah, we assume that it's Reb Meir's authorship. And velo Reb Yehuda sar velo k'Reb Yosi, and Reb Yehuda also doesn't hold like Reb Yosi, the Tanya, because the Braisa says in the Sifra, in the Torah's Kohanim, the Midrash on Vayikra, Daber al bnei Yisrael v'samach. Speak to the children of Israel and say to them, Adam ki akriv mikem, when a man brings a korban, the Torah then says, v'samach yado, he shall press down. So what we learn from the language of the pasuk is, bnei Yisrael samchin v'ein benos Yisrael samchas. That only Jewish men do smicha, but Jewish women do not do smicha. And Rabbi Yosi v'Rabbi Shimon omrim nashim samchos rishus. And Rabbi Yosi v'Rabbi Shimon disagree with the Tanakhama, and they say, no, if she wants to, she can. Ustam Sifra Mani, Rabbi Yehuda. Who is the author of the Sifra? When there's an anonymous statement in the Sifra, that's Rabbi Yehuda. So you see that both Rabbi Yehuda and Rabbi Meir hold that when a woman is exempt from a mitzvah, she may not do it. The very fact that the Braisa says that a woman is allowed to put on tefillin in order to save it shows me that she has a mitzvah of wearing tefillin. Once she has a mitzvah of wearing tefillin, we see that it is not a time-bound mitzvah, and ergo, Shabbos is also a time for wearing tefillin.
The Rabbi Yosi who says that she may not blow shofar.
No, that's not Rabbi Yosi, that's Rabbi Meir.
Rabbi Meir says she may not blow shofar. He uses the active, that she shouldn't listen to her, or that somebody shouldn't
listen
to her.
That's a very good question. I don't know. The Gemara leaves that as ambiguous, right? It's a good question. It seems like that the issue for Rashi, at least the way Rashi explains it, is that there's nothing wrong inherently with blowing a horn on Shabbos. It's not like you're doing any isser of like playing music or anything like that. So the only problem that there would be is that if you don't have a mitzvah, you shouldn't engage in it. Whether or not you can engage in a mitzvah passively just by listening, whether that's problematic or not, I can't tell you from this Gemara. It's a good point, though. Amar Rabbi Elazar, Hamotzei Tcheles B'Shuk, Lushanos P'sulos Chutin Kesherim. Now let's go on. Rabbi Elazar says that we're going to be discussing now the issue of this new tefillin, which according to our Mishnah, you do not have a heter to pick up or wear back with you if it's a new pair of tefillin that has not been knotted yet. So Rabbi Elazar says that if you find Tcheles, if you find blue dyed wool in the marketplace and you want to know, may I use this for tzitzis or not? Now, what's the issue? The issue is that in order to be able to use dyed wool for your tzitzis, it has to be done lishma. It has to be done for the sake of the mitzvah. If you dyed the wool blue and it wasn't done l'shem mitzvah tzitzis, then you may not use it for tzitzis. And so now you find stam blue wool in the shuk, and you don't know whether it was dyed for the sake of tzitzis or not. So if it's just raw wool that has not been turned into thread yet, but it's just like combed fleece that has been dyed, so then you're not allowed to use it for tzitzis because there's no indication that it has been manufactured for the purpose of tzitzis. But if you find it is already threads, it's been twisted into threads, so then you're allowed to use it. You can assume that it was manufactured for tzitzis. Frak de gemara maishna lishanos de amrina nadaita de glimat savinu, chutinamine madaita de glimat avinu. The Gemara says, but why should there be that difference? The reason why you can't just use combed fleece that's been dyed is because you have to be concerned that maybe it was dyed for just for textile use, not for tzitzis use. If that's the case, then blue thread also, maybe it was manufactured to be made into a garment, not to be manufactured as tzitzis. So the Gemara answers b'shezurim. We're not only talking about thread, we're talking about twisted thread. So it's been twisted to the point where it's like a plaited kind of thread that you would normally see on tzitzis. So the Gemara now says, Shazurim nami nema daita desifsa deglima ayafinu. But even twisted plaited thread, you could argue that it's made for the hemline, because it was very common. Even today we have this, you know, lots of hemlines have like tassel-like things at the end of it, like, you know, like the conservative or reform talus, right? It has like those tassels on the sides,
like fringes.
Like fringes, yeah. Or like a Mexican poncho, something like that, mm-hmm. Right? So maybe that's what it's for. How do you know that it's automatically for tzitzis? The Gemara answer is b'muvsakin dekulei hai vadei lo tarchi inchi. We're talking about where not only do you find blue plated threads, but you also find it that it is cut to very specific lengths. And when you want to make just fringes for the hem of a garment, you don't cut it to specific length because you want to stitch it together at the hemline. So you're not going to go to the extent of cutting it to specific sizes before you attach it to the garment. So therefore, the fact that it's been cut is an indication that it's been manufactured specifically for tzitzis. Amar Rava, v'chi adam tareach la'asos kameya kemin tefillin. So Rava says, well, if that's your argument, that you can assume based upon the way something is manufactured, that you can assume that it's for the mitzvah of tzitzis, why don't you say the same thing by tefillin? When you find a leather box that looks like tefillin, why would you have to worry that it was made as an amulet? Right? You think a person's going to go to the extent of making an amulet look like tefillin? Why would he do that? So ditnan b'medvar mamurim b'yishanas aval b'chadoshos potter. Like our Mishnah says, that if you have new leather boxes that have not been knotted with the ritzuos yet, so then you can't pick them up on Shabbos because you don't know whether they're really tefillin or not. But according to what you've said, if you can make an assumption by plaited strings of tcheles, why can't you make the assumption by boxes that look like tefillin, that they actually are tefillin? Amar Rebbe Zeira li'ahava berei puktani lehu hamotzei tcheles b'shuk l'shanos psulin chutin mufsakin kisherin l'fishen antoreach. So Rebbe Zeira said to Rabbi Ahava, his son, he says, you know what? Obviously there's a challenge to this teaching that if you find cut strings of tcheles, you can assume that they're for the purpose of tzitzis. He says, I want you to tell people that this is explicit in a brisa, that even though you don't know that it was manufactured for tzitzis, you're allowed to use it to put in your tzitzis. Make sure that they know this so that this should not be a challenged teaching. So Amar Rava, umishum detani la ahava berei de Reb Zeira kipi talala. So Rava says shkayach, basically. He's saying shkayach. Okay, fine, I understand that it's a brisa, but does it, just because it was taught in a brisa by Rabbi Ahava, does that mean that it has gold rings around it automatically? In other words, you still have to contend with the fact that it's contradicted by our Mishnah. You see that our Mishnah seems to disagree with that, because according to your Braisa, Rabbi Ahava, the son of Rabbi Zeira, any time that the circumstances indicate that it was made for a mitzvah, you can make that assumption. But our Mishnah says you cannot make that assumption, because you still have to worry that even though it looks like tefillin in all respects, it may still be an amulet. So therefore, Ella Amar Rava, Tarach Velo Tarach Tanoihi. You have to say that will a person go to the extent of making something look like a mitzvah artifact, even when it's not a mitzvah artifact, is a machlokas tanoim. That in itself is the machlokas, the tanya, and I'll show you this, because the Braisa says, and we just saw this above, hamod se tefillin machnisen zug zug, echad ha'ish ve'echad ha'isha, echad chadashos ve'echad yoshanos divir Rav Meir. That according to Rav Meir, if you find tefillin, it makes no difference whether you're a man or a woman, and it makes no difference whether the tefillin is new or old, you can assume that it was made for tefillin, and you can therefore wear it back to the yishuv. So you see that according to Rabbi Meir, you are allowed to assume that it was manufactured for the mitzvah, because otherwise why would a person go to the extent of manufacturing it to look that way? And Rabbi Yehuda Oser b'chadasha sumatir b'yashanos. Al-mamar savar tarach inish, umar savar lo tarach inish. And Rabbi Yehuda disagrees, and he says, like our Mishnah, that if it's brand new, you have to be chayshish, that maybe it wasn't manufactured for tefillin, even though it looks like it. And so therefore, what do you see? You see that this is a machlokas. Rabbi Meir says you are allowed to make the assumption, just like the Braisa that talked about Techela's strings. And Rabbi Yehuda disagrees, and he says you can't make that assumption unless you know for a fact that it was manufactured as tefillin, or that it was manufactured as tzitzis. And this, therefore, is the machlokas tanoim.
How can, according to Rabbi Meir, then, how can one wear the tefillin back on Shabbos if they're chadashos, if they don't have the straps on them?
Yeah. That's a very good question. That's a very good question. We're going to discuss that tomorrow. Have a wonderful day.